late 60s, the five Western universities decided they needed a marine station. And so they got together and decided that they were going to develop one, but they had to discover a place to have this thing. And I knew BC Waters extremely well. I mean, I've been around every inlet, every island from here up to Central Alaska. And so I was put in charge of a committee to go find a place for a marine station. And so the committee had five members plus myself. Each member represented a university. Each university had its spot already picked out. So we had to find the spot. And what was quite amusing was that all the spots that were picked out, Bamfield was on no one's list. It wasn't even on my radar, but a friend had told me, do think about it. And so we just stopped in one day, and it was really quite exciting because we had chartered a plane from Vancouver, so we had all our members on this float plane, and we went to Ucluelet and Tofino and Port Renfrew, Victoria itself, and when we were flying past Bamfield, I said, why don't we just stop in there? So we flew in, and we landed in here. This is Port Desire, part of Bamfield Inlet, and we taxied up to this float. And this old guy came down. And I remember I got out of the float plane. I'm standing on his float. Rain's running down my face. And I said to him, does it rain here much? He said, nope, it's usually just like this. And so when we flew out of Bamfield, we had crabs crawling around on the deck of the plane. We had smoked salmon. The whole community just took us in. And they didn't even know we were coming. But the other places that we visited knew we were coming, and they didn't give a damn. Excuse the expression. So the cable station was here. It was a perfect starting point for a marine station. And if you've been around here enough, you'll probably realize we have every kind of marine habitat within about a mile, kilometer radius. It's very good. I know more about kelp than anybody in the world. I can look in the mirror. I can say, I know all this stuff. It's wonderful. Now, if I was a doctor or a lawyer or an admiral or something like that, could I say that I know more about doing those things than anybody else in the world? I don't think so. So it's a good feeling. So I tell my students, just go out and identify with some little organism. You know, it could be a vent, I don't know, hot vent, tube worm, you know, or a lichen that grows only on the tops of the highest mountains or something like that. I've just become the world's expert, and you can look in the mirror and feel real good about it. The ecological significance of kelp is large. It's really restricted to shallow water, so you can't talk about it being a major influence in the world's oceans because most of the world's oceans are just very deep water. So it's a fringe element. As a fringe element, it provides essentially an architecture to what would be otherwise a boring ocean bottom. It gives a verticalness to it, so things can swim through it, they can eat it, they can hide in it, and such as that. So it's very important that way. Of course, the kelp is eaten by a variety of animals, and those animals are eaten by other animals, and so on and so on. For example, if you go to a cormorant, this is a diving bird that eats fish, 40% of the carbon in the cormorant is derived from kelp. So the kelp, through photosynthesis, ties up the carbon dioxide into its plant material, and then something eats that, and something eats that. And you can actually track it because there's different isotopes in a particular and very unique ratio. So wherever you see that ratio, you know that that carbon came from that source. As I was working with kelp as an academic exercise, I became aware that, particularly in Asia, they were farming kelp. And I thought that would be an interesting thing to do. And there's a point when you become established in your career, you can afford to research something that's not really going to advance you, simply because, and it might be my way of returning something to the public that made this life of kelp possible. So anyhow, I just did it. That was all. And And now we're helping other people set up farms as well. So our own farm, I have to hate to say this, but I will, sunk. Okay? It just sunk because we didn't use it for 1 year and it got grown over with all kinds of wonderful life. And so rather than disturb that wonderful life, we just kind of gave it a little burial. But at the same time, we're helping other people establish farms, both for conservation, where kelp beds are being disturbed because of man's activities or environmental change, and also ways for people to obtain food through a very sustainable manner.